Hello guys, it's Peter from PS Sound, and this is going to be another long video. It's been a while since I updated anything on YouTube. I've been pretty busy with everything happening with the new workshop, you could see from the previous video. But now I'm bringing more content to you guys. And in this one, you will see what we did in one of my team members' cars, where we changed the mid base, we did tests. So this is going to be a longer one, showing little tricks and tips, chasing rattles, a few tips regarding tuning. So stay around, it's going to be a long one, but it's definitely worth it. So enjoy the upcoming probably before it ends. It might be worth recording because this is exactly why I hate doors. So Gary's Vectra is here with me. You've seen pictures and videos of this car before. And now we are going to change mid-base, but he said he had rattles at times. And so now I connected the DSP, muted everything except the mid-base. It's playing between 70 and 250, 24 dB slopes. And it's horrible. And I was hunting down what's causing it. Because the door card doesn't reach the glove box. But for whatever reason, when the door shuts, when I open it, it doesn't rattle, but when it shuts, it pushes against something, probably down there, that just puts a bit of a stress on the door card, and then it starts to rattle around here, where the clips are, or the plastic hard surface reaching the inner skin of the door. But as you hear now, it's pretty clean. You shut it, and it's horrible. So that will need a bit of attention. But yeah, unfortunately Vauxhall, or in Europe it's Opel, it's generally, you know, it's not the best quality materials, and then things can come alive. Even if I turn it up a bit louder, I can hear rattles coming from the other side, things come alive. Yeah, we will attack that issue. So just to minimize those rattles, we also added a bit extra tender loving care to this door card, because that wasn't anything done on the door card, which wasn't that important because the door itself is fully isolated. But there are areas where the door card still sits against hard surface, like on the top, really hard plastic sitting onto the inner skin of the door can cause rattle there. Also little clips can move in that plastic mounting, so we put 3M tape on them and squash them back in, then they don't rattle. You can see there, it's nice and firm. Just a bit more deadening to the actual panel, but the driver is gonna sit against this foam. It's not gonna touch anything. We added a bit of foam here because we have that plastic box there in case that plastic reached anything, but now it's gonna squash against this foam. And this thing from Silent Coat is the is it the 50 mil absorber that can squash down all the way to like 1 or 2 mil. So as you see, it takes the shape up really well. So now it's ready to go back. But also we realized one thing. So where you have screws holding the armrest on, because obviously that's where you grab the door all the time, most of the manufacturers have fixing around the armrest, that's just fine, those screw points are rigid. But then at the bottom of the door there were 3 self-tapping screws, and one of them was already really on the way out, so we drilled them up and fitted riv nuts, riveted inserts, threaded inserts. So now we can bolt the door card on with meshing bolts properly. So it's gonna hold it way better. It's not gonna fail. A new birch ply mounting ring for the driver, all stainless bolts, threaded inserts in the wood for the driver, all bolted in. We will see how much it helps. So this is the interesting part when people try to judge speakers based on the looks, and straight away they would say that, you know, that is a joke because it has a tiny magnet, contact power, it's a no-no. Maybe go for that, because it's beastier, it has a bigger magnet, or at least a cover. Well, it's definitely a wider magnet. Coil, oh, I don't know, what is that? Probably like an inch or 30 mil. And as opposed to that, this thing is, doesn't look anything that special, but I said it before, it doesn't look special, but that small magnet is very, very strong. And all the soft parts are just the right ingredients. That's a pretty stiff driver with a stiff rubber surround. Whereas that thing is so soft. Look at that. I'm pressing it roughly around with the same force. It's a really low loss driver. So every single tiny little movement in the cone becomes sound. Well, from that one too, but I've never really liked stiff drivers. And yes, maybe it can take a bit more power. But what's the point? Because that thing is definitely more sensitive and musical. But we will see. We will see, because we've done measurements before and after. We will drop that in the micro precision and see what it plays like, what it measures like. Yeah, I'm very interested. So another little test. Sub integrates the front really well, except one annoying buzz from the back. And you try to deal with it for a while.
Yeah, I've tried.
You tried all sorts of things with the target and it was always buzzing. It's not even loud. The sub is not even moving a millimeter, but it makes the target between 42 and 48 hertz buzz as hell. So you can see what's happening. It's not as bad now, but we were looking for, you know, what's happening, because the whole target is deadened. Inside you have everything you could do, and then you think it's the locking mechanism, maybe, because you don't apply much force, or you push the target down and it stops doing it. So I did a little test for Gary. Bring me that phone. So I suspected that when the target shuts down, this area sits onto that really hard plastic. And then I was just like, let's just put a small piece of foam here. So when you shut it back down, let's see what happens. And it's minimized. So what we're gonna do, we will have a strip of foam on the target at that area there, which won't look pretty, but when it's shut, then you will have isolation between one hard surface and the other hard surface, and then this shit is gonna be minimized. So it's not inside of that. It's surfaces reaching each other. The very same thing as we've done on the door cards. You wanna separate hard surfaces from each other. Little tricks. And it's done. It's clean, it doesn't buzz. It's still the same level. And you don't hear any rattle now coming from the back. It's just clean signal. It's one of those things, and that's what people have to understand when they expect a build to be as good as possible for the first time. You know, when it's done, then you have to trace rattles and buzzes and everything, and that can take long time or experience, because now I just came up with that, you know, in a minute. I'm like, let's try that. I think it's that dang done.
So simple.
All right, so as I'm explaining to Gary in his car what's happening at the same time I record it, so we have footage of it. So I measured the drivers in near field, the mic put as close to the driver as possible, where you kind of filter out the cabin as much as you can, but of course it still plays a role. And then I also measured them from listening position. Let's go one by one. Ah, no, clear. So that's why we started with driver's side listening position with the Hertz drivers. They are playing full range in all measurements, no filters, nothing, no EQ. Everything is bypassed on them. So this was the Hertz. Driver side always suffers in most cars from this problem. And usually at around 80 Hertz as well. There's a dip. This is not as drastic, but this is a big problem. If you can't do much with it, you would have to relocate the mid bass. Because you look at it from near field, obviously the measurement level is higher. And it's pretty clean up to that point. And it starts to roll off. Also because we have an inbuilt filter on the top end in the amp. They have a 1.2K filter, low-pass filter. In that amplifier, that's the only thing that you cannot bypass on those SP range Zepcos. And that starts to come in a roll. But it's not an issue for a mid-bass. It doesn't matter in freeway. But as you see, it's clean there. Down to 70-ish. It's functional. And then there's a difference what happens when you listen to it from driver position. Again, this is a good example when people think that, oh, I have the best driver in my doors and it sounds so good. No, this is actually, you know, exactly what you hear. A fucking mess that you have to sort out somehow. But it's quite difficult most of the times, especially when you have two-way. Good luck pairing it with a tweeter. With a wideband, it would be doable easily. So let's just compare now the listening position to the micro precision listening position. So this is what we get, right side. So that dip is similar, although there's a difference there. But the low end is way more sensitive. Why is that? Let's have a look at it from near field, which is here. Okay. So, slightly less sensitive, although these drivers are brand new, straight out of the box. So that may affect things. There's a 1.5, less than 2 dB difference over there. But under 70 Hertz, there's a good 3 dB difference at the low end, 74.5, and that peak is 78.7, more than 4 dB there. So under 70 Hertz, this has way more low end, which is clearly the reason why we just turned the system on, turned the sub off, we took the high-pass filters off the mid-bass in the doors. And I've heard this from other people before, that these drivers, they don't look anything special, but they have really low FS, they can be driven easily, and their output at the low end is just ridiculous. Gary was also like, all right,
yeah.
Is the sub on? I'm like, nope. Okay. So, yeah, we don't necessarily need that extra level, though. If you didn't have a sub in the car, you could still build a pretty good car without a sub, and it would play down to 40 Hertz easy. That is a bigger dip there. But overall, the curve looks similar. Clearly shows that what you hear is the cabin, really, more than anything. The problem what you have there, the same way you have with both drivers, same there. The peak you have over there is a little bit less with the micro precision, but you still have a peak there. And the rest is very similar. This is now on a 112 of an octave smoothing. If we were looking at it without smoothing, of course it would look a bit messier, but it would show things better. Yeah, that has a dip there. Although, okay, it's not just a straight speaker swap. Not quite, because we added that little bit of a treatment to the door. Whether that could change anything, but the door was well sealed
from the inside of the door, nothing could come through. We didn't change anything there, so I wouldn't consider that as a reason why.
It's only the rings we changed from it.
Yeah, the mounting ring, but that doesn't make a difference. Mm-hmm. But that is narrow, but still, that's a difference there. Interesting. But overall, the curve is very similar. Just has more low end. Let's go back to 112. Otherwise, it's too messy to understand. So, let's go to the other side. So, left hertz. This was the hertz. From listening position, and then left micro precision listening position. Overall, the curve is very similar, and again, under 80 hertz, that's just more level with the driver. Like over there, 64, 68, 4 dB. Pretty much 3-4 dB more under 80 hertz, so double the output under 80 hertz. So when people say that, the hertz can take more power, fair enough, but then this driver requires half the power to get the same level. And then if you give it the same power, as you see, it gives more output under 80 hertz. If someone wants that nice punch up front and wants to abuse his doors, if they handle it without rattle, then yeah, these drivers would play that range very well. But overall, the rest is very similar, a little bit less level over there. But we can easily reset the levels. That's just fine. And as I say, these are brand new, out of the box. Okay. But from listening position, left, and then left, same way. So it shows a little bit less sensitivity in the spectrum, except under 80 hertz, there's more level at the low end. Yeah. So there's no drastic difference, really, but there shouldn't be, because what you measure from listening position is mainly the cabin. If you could measure a big dip or something in the response from near field, that could indicate issues with the driver or the application, that the door is not sealed, for example, or the driver has some sort of weird stuff happening. But they are both pretty linear from near field. And it's also a good indication where the drivers start to roll off. You don't want to abuse a driver where it starts to roll off. That's pretty much the point where it drops under FS. And yes, base drivers are usually used under FS, but mid-base, 6.5-inch mid-base shouldn't be really used under that point. And I think the hertz has fairly high FS, so that's probably the reason why it doesn't want to play with that great level underneath that point. When you see that extra level at the low end from listening position, that's due to the cabin gain, how much the cabin boosts and it pushes that low end. And then with the micro precision, hang on, you get a fair amount of low end over there. You get more low end from passenger side always, because it's further away from you. The wave has more distance from you. Well, the wave has more chance, or better chance, to develop because it has more distance from you. Do I say it clearly? Yep. It's always clear in my mind the way, but the way I explain it, that's a different story, especially as English is not my first language, but hopefully people understand it. So that's left, right. So from this mess, we have to EQ these drivers out as balanced as possible again, so they integrate to the mids. So that's the next job. So yeah, it's quite interesting that Gary was also saying that, he tried to find that rattle with music, but it's difficult because you hear it at times, you don't hear it at other times. So if you want to chase rattles, just get a signal generator. I'm using that thing. signal gen, that's what it's called. I just tap on it. And then it does all sorts of things for you. You know, you can set the band, set the frequency, level, hit play, and it goes. It's that easy. Simple as that. And then you can trace all these buzzes, which can ruin the listening experience. Well, let's just get back to this scenario. So we had the comparison between the mid-bass hertz and the micro-precision. And you all have to understand that the frequency response is not the only thing you have to pay attention to. And yes, it's difficult to measure the rest. That really plays a big role. But yes, you could. You could do waterfall measurements. But I don't have time for that either. And to be fair, if you are experienced, but yes, that's tricky. You have to have experienced ears to hear the difference between drivers, because how transient a driver is a different story. But put it simple, you know, when the driver gets a signal from the amplifier, how fast it responds, what the attack is like on a driver, and then decay, that's a different story. When the signal stops, does the driver stop straight away, or you have a bit of overhang on it, and then an extra note added to it, decaying off. It might be just a tiny, tiny little thing, but it adds color to the sound. And what you want, that the driver responds is as accurate as possible to the signal. And you can really hear it when you listen to certain technical songs. Overall, it's definitely way more musical driver. Yes, we could see from the response that it plays lower. Yes, we had fun with it. We drop the crossover lower, and it makes the car go absolutely silly. It feels a bit like you have a sub in the car and a sub is not even playing. You can do that trick. However, when you have so much energy from the driver playing down low, the whole door comes alive, and you need a lot of work to treat the door not to rattle, and you know, they wouldn't want to fall apart. In some cars, yes, you can do a good job, but this is a Vauxhall, or in Europe, yes, it's an Opel. This is not a great interior, you know. Plastic, cheap mounting solutions. And as you could see, we've done a lot to it, but it's still giving us headache at times. And because of that, I had to do tricks with the tuning as well. Well, let's just go through what have happened here. So we had the measurements, and then I had to select a crossover point for the mid-bass drivers. So actually we went with 50 to 250. Before, the hertz was 70 to 250. So now we let these micro-precision drivers play slightly lower because they just deal with it easily. So left bass crossover, and from that I had left bass EQ to follow the target line. That's just too much level at the low end. And yes, people say that, okay, Pete, you crossed it at 50, that driver is gonna struggle. But because the cabin creates so much level, as you see, like extra 7-8 dB, if you tune properly, EQ properly to the target curve, you get that level pulled down, and then the driver sees 1/4 of the power at those low frequencies, and you still have the right level, enough response in the cabin. So the other was right bass, that was messier, and then right bass EQ. So left and right was EQ'd, matching each other as close as possible. As you could see from the right hand side driver, that has quite big acoustical issues. There's a big dip here. That's a room related problem, between, you know, 115 and 160. It's a bit like a center frequency point at like 130. So the tuning would require to pull that level up as much as possible. But what normally happens is that extra energy is just getting into the door, and you know, you push like extra 6 dB, like 130 with a wider Q, it will make the whole door work really hard and rattle, come alive. You need that level to get the spectral balance right. If you don't do it, you will feel like the lower mid-range and the upper bass is just weak, and it's because of the phase problem. So there's no right thing. If you push the EQ into it, you will have rattles. It will also pull your center focus a little bit towards the right, because you have a problematic area there with a face problem. Then you push EQ into it, it will just pull that side. It will never lock to the center in that range. So you can do tricks, you know, you can drop the level, but then you lose from spectral balance. So not to lose that much from spectral balance, then you can add that, what you dropped from this side, you can add that to that side. Technically it's not right, but it's a compromise. People have to understand car audio is a big compromise. Hope it now makes sense. So yes, they measure left, right, as balanced out as possible, but after that I listened to it and I had to do my own little tricks, what I mentioned earlier. There you go, I've given something away from you now. And the pair still measured pretty well. Then we had the dash that needed a bit of tweaking, because that was the measurement from the last tune I had on the car like half year ago. Everything has run in, so it required a bit more flattening. That's with a 1/6. So that needed a bit of tweaking, because there was a bit of a peak there and up there to make it more ironed out, balanced out, more linear. And yes, the mid-bass level was a bit too much as well. It was a bit too boomy. For daily, it's great, but if you want to listen to music accurately, then it was just a bit too much rise under 200 Hz. Ideally, you want that 3 dB rise under 200 Hz per octave. I've mentioned this before in previous tuning videos. And we had the sub. That's pretty good down to 23. And then, yes, you would need that rising curve to carry on under that, but with the box it's not going to happen. To be fair, it's in a small sealed box and that Helix does a great job, absolutely fine job. And then once it's all playing together, then we end up with something like this. So it's linearly rising and it's playing really nicely together. And then yeah, once you have something linear, then you can play with it by ear. Do you have enough top ends? For some people, yes I do. Or maybe too much, then you can pull that down. Or if you want more detail on the top end, you can push it up. Is it too harsh in the vocal range? Female vocals sound a bit too harsh, then drag it down in the upper mid-range and lower high frequency range. You can play with these things. Someone likes it warmer, push the lower mid-range up. But always tune the system linear, then you can do what you want with it. It's a bit like cooking a cake and someone wants a bit more this, a bit more that. But the basics have to be done first, so the system plays together as one, not just speakers separately all over the place. So yeah, tuning madness with the Zapco DSP Z8 Mark II. Yeah, Helix DSP-3 would do an equally good job. Sound-wise, they both sound great. I still find Zapco a bit more musical. And I can work with it well, it's that easy. EQ band, type in which band, you just hit tab, it jumps to the frequency, you type in tab, then the level, tab, Q, next band. So this is that easy to set the EQ and everything. Fully parametric, 30 bands, 31. That easy. Everything is on one page. Time alignment, our usual Shazam. So, that's pretty much it. And then I guess I should play some music for you, right? Because people always wonder. And then YouTube can kill me, as always. So I play this in the Porsche Taycan. Whoops. Well, I can see it in the video. We call that project the Secret Project, right? Because, yeah, we couldn't name it online. But everyone could see what car it was. The way this track starts with the kick bass and the double bass, or the bass guitar, it's just so accurate. Hang on, let's go back.
Walk along the levee, see the dirty man. The dirt neath my feet, baby, turning to quicksand. You looked into my palm, then looked me in the eye, told me you were gone, gone over the horizon. Once we stood together.
So, you know, as it comes in, the kick bass is really on point. It hits clean, and you can hear every single note on the bass guitar. If it's muffled or it's not well defined, then you have issues there in the response. It's not gonna happen. And if everything is balanced out, timed out, then it's rock solid right over there. So, let's see. Good old classic.
Of life's and love's a labyrinth, and reason to suspect that I'm meant for this. A smile, a song, a tender kiss. Thanks to you. There's a thing I think I know. I really mean a variations on that theme. Thanks to you, I have time to turn, time to cool and time to burn. And thanks to you, there's something certainly too good to miss. In other words, a way through this. And just when one... These are called for senses. The boss wanna know what's going on. So Joseph and Mary hit the road, with Mary nigh on 9 months gone. And you know we're talking about a hell of a walk, and they had no place to stay. They tried the inns and the hotels, the message was plain as day. You get no refuge, no respite, and no sanctuary here. No refuge, no respite, and no sanctuary here. Juan had his Juanita and a baby boy they named Miguel. On the other side of the...
I know this system sounds wicked. Check out the description I'm gonna put in the playlist for this car. You can see the evolution of it. I know I got comments that these dashboards were not the best looking ones, and it's really not the, you know, everyone's favorite. But again, it's tricky in some cars where these pillars have absolutely no depth, nothing behind them. You can't build onto the pillar. We didn't want to modify the dash, and these dashboards were pretty much the only option. They are bolted through the factory vent holes. They were little tiny vent holes blowing air to the side, so we had that sacrifice. We got rid of those, and then we could bolt the pod through them. This vent comes out, and then you can put a knot from underneath so those things don't move anywhere. It's not quite finished. We were never really sure about what finish we wanted on them, so we just got a simple, you know, black paint finish. But I left the gap around the driver, because if you want to trim it, then we can make it nice and flush once the trim is pushed into that groove. Yeah, one day we will get to that as well. But this is another
you know, ongoing project for one of the, our team members, for Gary. We just do things in small stages. But now, yeah, this system is definitely playing beautifully. Audible Physics, RAM 3A, RG52 Eater, now the Micro Precision 5 Series mid bass, Helix Q12 at the back end sealed. That's not really used for anything. PATRS, Zepco DSP, Z842. Z84 Mark II, and then SP range 6 channel amp, and then an SD range 850 XM monoblock for the sub. That's it. Nothing crazy. Decent equipment, well installed. Let's go back to this. I love the way it starts. Mustard, that's for sure. Sounds wicked. All sorts of stuff here. A bit of electronic.
Oh, because I explained earlier what we had at the back. Now I show it again, but you can see it in the playlist. So the Helix Q12W. We had to have the magnet reversed because the box is very shallow. It's super shallow following the angle of the rear seat. And before we had the, what did you have, the Genesis sub or Peerless? We had the Peerless sub, which could get into that box, but not this. This is a very deep driver. And a very sexy sub, that's for sure. It sounds nice. Maybe it's not as accurate as an Alianti or like the beautiful Accuton sub. Oh, I have it here. I haven't even shown it to you. Yeah, I'm going to show it. All the guys on YouTube haven't even seen that. They have to go on Facebook and then check the pictures. No, you know what? I just dropped a few pictures here in this video. They will see. I have a very tasty sub that's going into a nice project very soon in a few weeks' time. But overall, it's a great sounding daily sub, and you can blast it as well. It can take the power. It can go silly, definitely. So that's Zepco SP Range 6 channel. And then we have, can we lift this? Oh, it's very cold now, isn't it? And we have the SD 850 monoblock running the sub. ESP over there. What was this? Oh, you had the bridged.
That's from all the old RCA.
Yeah, the old RCA, yeah, we don't use that. Simple as that. And then daily cover, something in front of the sub, a carpet in front of the sub, so it's still functional. And then it can be lifted up, spare wheel is right underneath. So, simple. There you go, this is the end of this video, guys. And he's not coming in! Come on, Gary, you gotta show yourself.
Crack your screen.
Right. Proper hoodie, that's how you work, because we were working hard today to make this thing happen. It wasn't just me working on this car. And that's a beautiful thing in my team, that some of the guys, most of the guys, work on their cars and then they do hard work. They understand exactly what it takes to build good sounding cars. When did you start the Backtrack project?
This one? Yeah. 2 years ago. Well, 18 months ago. Originally. I've had the car 2 years.
Really?
I know. That's pretty
more
bit
than that.
Probably 3 years.
You missed a year. We had COVID.
Yeah. It's been a long year. It's been a long, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, no, 3 years.
Yeah, because we did what we did more than a year ago, and then before that you had Genesis amps and all that, and we built that a year before that.
Got it. Yeah. Wow. Yeah.
But it's evolving. First you had two-way, and then we went three-way.
Yeah.
From the head unit DSP, we went to a standalone DSP.
Yep.
Step by step. Yeah, if someone doesn't have, you know, 10 grand in the pocket and go silly.
I didn't.
And many people don't. And that's a beautiful thing. Now people can see a system that's way cheaper than some of the crazy systems I build. And then people complain that, you know, Pete, are you only doing high-end systems now? Not at all. But, well, come to the next meeting, which I may actually advertise it here right now, but I will have a separate video, just short video for the meeting. I'm going to put it up tonight because officially today rules changed in the UK, so we are allowed to have outdoor meetings. I haven't checked the news yet, but apparently that's what's happening. My missus already said that the restaurants were open inside as well, and cinemas and theatres, yay! So we will have the first meeting on the 30th this month, 30th of May in Chingford. For the details, you will have to check the next video. I'm going to put it up tomorrow on YouTube, probably. Maybe even tonight, we will see. And then you can see the location and everything we will put into the description. Anyone is welcome, except crazy boomers. That's not allowed. You know, we don't want board cars or crazy big loud bass cars. That's not what the meeting is about. Purely sound quality. You can listen to your system or show your system to anyone inside. Door shut. There's no problem with that. but we don't want police or anyone coming out just because we are too loud, so people have to respect it. Simple as that. Popover, I'm sure we will have many cars, at least 20, 30 cars. I expect maybe even more, so people can listen to.
Yeah, it's a nice bunch of lads as well. And ladies.
We have to have lunch.
And ladies.
Yeah. Sometimes we have nice ladies.
Yeah.
My missus won't come, that's for sure.
But
it's better for us, otherwise we would be. Come on, when are we going home?
Yeah.
Just the usual.
Yeah.
So this is it for this one. I don't know, this is going to be another long video. Yeah, more is coming soon, but I've been super busy with this workshop. It's coming together now. And we have another nice car right there. Gary's hiding. Two blue cars.
Yep.
But people know that one. So this is it. Subscribe to the channel if you're not subscribed yet, because then you won't miss the next video. And then feel free to share this video. I know many people find inspiration in these, and feel free to comment as per usual. And see you in the next one.